ATN World News. News and inspiration with Leah Tillock.
Hello and welcome to ATN World News. I'm Leah, and it's great to be with you, the listeners, around the world. Well, today, I can't begin to tell you how thrilled and how happy I am to have Dallas Holm with us. And I know that many of you know that name and know his music. For those who don't, Dallas is a singer-songwriter of Christian music. He's garnered gold records and multiple Dove Awards, Grammy nominations, and several number one songs. And throughout all of this, Dallas extols the glory of God. And with that, I want to say good morning, Dallas.
Good morning to you, Leah. Thank you.
Wow. It's just wonderful to have you here. This is going to be an excellent broadcast. And, you know, Dallas has some pretty awesome music. And, of course, the one song he's most well known for that touches the heart and the emotions every time you hear it is Rise Again. And I'm going to take a few minutes, let our listening audience hear this beautiful piece of work that was inspired by the Holy Spirit. And here's Dallas Holm, Rise Again.
Go ahead, drive the nails in my hands, let me where you stand. Go ahead.
Well, amen. I've got to say that that song always evokes emotion in me. I know that Dallas has mentioned that he really felt that the Holy Spirit wrote this through him. And we're going to touch on some issues that are currently going on today. And before we do that, I do want to ask Dallas a little bit more about Rise Again. When you wrote this, Dallas, what was going through your mind? What was God speaking to you?
Well, I actually wrote the song in 1976, and it was at the time when we were, I had been a solo artist up until that time. I was traveling with a man named David Wilkerson, who is best known for his book, The Cross and the Switchblade. When I started out in ministry, we worked on the streets in New York with the gangs and the drug addicts and traveling in what we called youth crusades around the world, youth-oriented, large meetings. And in 76, we just, we came to the conclusion that a band, a live group would probably be more palatable to the especially young audience that we were singing to. So in the process of thinking, putting a band together, I realized I'd have to write some new music. And normally I was able to sit down, just grab a piece of paper and a pen and, come up with some ideas. This particular day, just nothing. I was just so absolutely empty of any creativity or any idea. Finally, in prayer, which I should have done in the first place, but in the course of praying about it, at one point I said, Lord, if you were singing, what would you say? And that thought stuck in my mind. I thought that was a challenging thought. I didn't know if I'd ever heard a song from a first-person point of view. So I just focused on that. And I didn't hear any voices out of heaven. There were no thunder claps or lightning bolts. But very quickly, I would say in about 10, 15 minutes tops, I wrote the words, the music, everything. It literally was like taking dictation. And no changes, no alterations, just wrote it out. Looked at it when I was done. I said, God wrote the song, and I just delivered the message. And that may sound presumptuous to some, but there's no better way I can explain it. There's probably only been three songs that have come to me out of all the songs I've written in that very sudden fashion. And that was the first one that I'd ever experienced anything like that. And of course, the rest is history. As they say, the Lord has just used that song in a tremendous way. It certainly opened up our ministry internationally, and still, it's a song, especially this Easter season. I mean, it's just sung all over the world, and I thank the Lord for it, because it is the essence of the gospel message.
It absolutely is, and whenever I would listen to it, I would say, this is Jesus speaking to me. And it was a message that I believe Jesus himself wanted to give to the world. He wanted to talk. As the days of old, like the Bible, they were inspired when the Holy Spirit came upon them to write the messages that God had for the world. And it was a timely message, and it's a timeless one. And it does evoke emotion and touches you deeply, because you do hear it from Jesus. It was even sung that way, like it was Jesus saying it. So I want to thank the Lord for giving the world the song through you. And I want to thank you for all that you've done and ministered. And I think there's so many people around the world that would like to say, gee, thank you, Dallas, for helping us and ministering to us through this wonderful music. So I will say it on their behalf. And speaking of people around the world, now our broadcast goes into some unique places in third world countries, as well as Europe and America. And there's a lot going on in the news today, and as some people know, we are doing a special series where we are having your favorite Christian artist speak on current events, because there's so much going on today, especially if you know Scripture in light of Bible prophecy. And what I want to do is I want to open up the mic to Dallas, hand it over to him, and Dallas, there are so many different things going on that are of biblical proportions. I'm going to let you choose a topic that you'd like to speak on to our listening audience. Thank you.
Well, I think it's a wonderful point to launch off into this from the song Rise Again, because in the song Rise Again, you have the life, the death, the resurrection, and the announcement that he will return. And that's where we live our lives these days. Looking for the return of Christ. It's a literal return. It is clearly outlined in Scripture. For those scoffers or hesitant ones or the so-called atheists, really there are no atheists, because by definition, an atheist is one who has exhaustively studied, pursued the idea of proving there is no God and has succeeded in doing so, and upon that proof has become an atheist. Well, obviously, no one has proven that there is no God. So I always say to people who claim they're an atheist, I just say, no, you're not an atheist. You just don't want to be a Christian. Because there is more historical, archaeological, manuscriptural evidence for Christianity than there are all other religions of the world combined by a great deal. In fact, I was reading a book just recently, just some study material, and even the secular humanist scientists and philosophers, they all agree on one thing historically, and they cited from several well-known scientists. It is absolutely indisputable that the baptism and the crucifixion of Jesus, those are indisputable historical facts. Now, the issue is who this Jesus was and is. That's where they depart. But there's no question about it happened historically. The evidence is overwhelming. Whether he is who he claimed to be, the Son of God, for we who believe, we know that that's a fact that is accepted by faith. And the Bible says without faith, it's impossible to please God. So by believing, assessing the evidence, and believing by faith that he is who he said he was, then we enter this this journey with the Lord. The Bible says we are co-laborers together with Christ Jesus, no longer slaves or hirelings, but sons and daughters of the living God. So he gives us amazing privilege, and we live our lives out of a gratitude for his grace that he has shed abroad in our hearts. So that's one issue for those who may be, you know, just, well, I don't believe any of this stuff, which... why are you listening to us? But I'm glad you are. I believe we may be the ones who live in the final ticks of the clock. Interestingly enough, just last night I was refreshing my mind through some systematic theology books on end time doctrine. And of course, without getting into all of it, but I mean, you have amillennialists, postmillennialists, premillennialists, pre-trib millennialists, mid-trib, post-trib, you know, all these different doctrinal beliefs about when the Lord's going to return, what the events of his return will be, at what point he will return in regards to the Great Tribulation, of which Scripture speaks clearly in the millennial reign of Christ. But just kind of, in a way, wipe that all off, because you can spend forever batting it back and forth like a ping pong ball about all these doctrinal issues. The fact is, the one thing that all agree upon is Christ is going to return. And the Bible teaches clearly that he is gracious enough to give us some indications as to when that return will be. And I break it down into two categories. There's that which is happening in the world at large, and then there's that which is happening in the church or the body of Christ or the Christian community. There are signs in both. I just did in a general overview of world events. I mean, I get up in the morning and I usually turn the news on first and just see what's happening in the world today. And there's always been wars, rumors of wars, earthquakes, natural disasters, calamities. There's always been those things. But I think it can be argued that it's never been on a scale or the potential for literal mass destruction of millions, if not the planet. And it just seems to be intensifying, even in nature. It just seems every day you just expect to hear something more about what the Bible calls, you know, the birth pangs of planet Earth. I mean, groaning for, you know, looking forward to the kingdom. So I think with, you know, that Mideast region over there, my goodness, it's like a gigantic pool of gasoline waiting for someone to just come by and flick a match. This is the world we live in. Just the mere thought of Iran getting nuclear weapons, I mean, the chief sponsor of terrorism in the world, all of a sudden they can rain down a nuclear holocaust upon Israel or anybody they want, you know, as their capabilities increase. That's a sobering, sobering thought. And it seems as though we don't have enough wisdom sometimes to even know how to confront that or deal with that or speak of it for what it is. And I just look at all these things. I mean, as I study Scripture, I don't see any prophetic signs that are yet unfulfilled. Now, there are those who do. There are those who argue. Some take the stand that, you know, it says, well, until all the earth has heard the gospel. So they say, you know, until the gospel has been preached in every nation. Well, mathematically, culturally, that's going to be impossible at the rate that nations are born and people groups start up. When you read a more thorough scrutiny of that, even in the original language, it has more to do with, I hate to use the word symbolic, but I mean, even in the time of Christ, even in the time of the epistles, they were talking about going into all the earth and preaching the gospel so that all would hear. It's a more general sense of it is made available, even with what we're doing here now in this interview, that the gospel is available all over the world. It isn't speaking to specific geographical until this country has, you know, the missionary stand on the corner and preach the gospel. Now, that's open for debate, but I feel confident in that interpretation. And there are some others that people weigh in on, but at least with the crowd I hang out with, and I have the privilege to rub shoulders with some pretty pretty major theologians, and I thank the Lord for that. And my understanding is that we are in that time when the Lord could return, and so we live our lives in that state of readiness. Now, looking at the church, I remember growing up in the church, and I often heard sermons about the great falling away or the apostasy. And as crazy as this sounds, I was raised in a Christian family. I went to church, but I was not a Christian. I didn't live for Jesus for a long time. I believed in God. I believed the scriptures were true. I just didn't want to commit to it. I thought when I get older and slow down, don't know how to have fun anymore, I'll get saved to make it to heaven. And when I'd hear about the great falling away, I remember kind of making a mental note, oh, okay, when that happens, pay attention. That would be a good time to get saved because the coming of the Lord would be soon. I know that sounds really stupid, but that was my game plan. I used to think the great falling away would be a very visible, you know, people by droves leaving the church, backsliding, just turning their back on God. I believe that we are in the great falling away. Now, it may just be the beginning stages of it. There may be something greater yet to come, but my perspective is a unique one in that I still travel in just about every denomination you can think of. I've been to every corner of every state in the United States, been to about 21 countries around the world. It gives you a unique perspective. And I believe the great falling away is happening, and where it's happening is within the church. And they're not leaving physically, but the Bible says in the last days, and that's a key word, in the last days, men will not endure sound doctrine. Seeking to have their ears tickled, they will accumulate unto themselves teachers in accordance with their own doctrines, ever learning but never coming into the knowledge of the truth. Boy, if that doesn't describe, especially in the church in America, we have more frivolous, shallow, perverted teaching on faith, for example. We have guys that are just totally perverting the scripture knowingly to build their own kingdoms and line their own pockets, telling people lies that cannot be backed up by scripture. There's never been such a time, and not only are it's not being done on a small scale. Some of the absolute largest churches in America, if not the world, will not even preach the gospel. They won't even reference sin. They won't make mention of the blood of Jesus. They give excuse to sinners with some perverted sense of grace and tolerance. And it really is breathtaking to behold. There are best-selling books written on, you know, ideas that, well, there really is no hell. There can't be a hell because God's a God of love and mercy, and he wouldn't do that. And people are just falling in line. No matter what scripture says clearly, which it does, people are choosing to have their ears tickled and go other directions. The sobering thought of this is the Bible speaks of those who do such things. And it says in that final day when all men, you know, come and give an account before the Lord, there will be many, it says, who will say, Lord, Lord, we did great and mighty things in your name. We cast out devils. We, you know, did all the stuff. And it's interesting to note that the Lord does not take exception with that. God doesn't say, oh, no, you didn't. So we assume from that there are people who do great, amazing things, but it's not of the Lord. They create large kingdoms and ministries and are master manipulators. But in that final day, God is going to say, I don't know who you are. Depart from me. You know, and that's a sobering thought. False teachers have always been. Paul spoke against them in the epistles, but we abound with false teachers today who are perverting the gospel and leading many astray. And I believe the falling away is happening within the church, and there's such a deception, delusion that they don't even know it. So I look at the scope of all that and say, surely the Lord's coming is near because he predicted these things specifically and referenced them by saying in the last days these things will happen. So We occupy till he comes.
Wow. Have you ever hit the nail on the head? I mean, on several issues. I've had some of the top eschatology teachers on my broadcast in the past, and I'm going to say that most of them agree that Bible prophecy, all of it has been fulfilled. I agree with you. I mean, David Wilkerson spoke out against these false teachers and false prosperity message, which is a twisting, a complete upside down effect is going on, an Antichrist spirit upside down going on around the world. It is rampant. Things have increased. I appreciate the poignant points you brought out about, well, the gospel has gone on, and yes, there is a great falling away because they are not able to endure sound doctrine. And I mean, there's a powerful thing that God is saying here when he says they can't even hear it. They can't endure hearing the truth. And you have to love the truth to see it or to know it and to hear it. And when you talk about God will say, well, yeah, you've done all these things, but I don't know you. When you stop to think that heaven or hell, where we spend eternity, is based on whether God knew us or not, that then becomes, well, an intimate relationship with him is extremely important. You know, you can't be a fly-by-night with God. He has to know you. And whereas some of these men have done, as the scripture says, wonderful things, they did it with ulterior motives for building and garnering and getting money. You know, God's not stupid. And it always surprises me how many people think he's stupid. You know, like, you know, like they'll come up. I'm going, really? You think he's that stupid?
Really?
And he does know. And you keep seeing them coming up with more gimmicks for money. Jesus was not about building mammoth concrete buildings when there's people that are starving to death. I mean, that's an actual insult to people who are starving. Listeners, I'm sure you've heard that the points that Dallas made, this broadcast is going to be available on iTunes so that you can download it for free. I encourage you to share it with your friends. And, you know, people that may be going to a church that doesn't broach this topic or touch on these issues. And like I said, there were some seriously good issues touched on today with Dallas, and we're going to be ending this program in a few minutes. I'm going to ask Dallas to stick around afterwards in the screen room for some final talks. But for right now, Dallas, is there anything else you'd like to share with our listening audience? We have about 2 minutes.
Well, just the absolute necessity. I encourage people more and more all the time, become a student of Scripture. Never has there been a time where there are more marvelous Bible studies, Bible teachings. Get some of the old books. I love to, not saying there aren't some new good ones, but I love to read the Spurgeons and Whitfields and Wesleys and Moody's and on and on, because these men crafted the foundation of our faith. Make sure you're plugged into a church that's teaching the Word of God, not just preaching sermons, not giving motivational speeches. There's a great, great need for sound biblical teaching and preaching in the church, and it is lacking greatly. And the church, by and large, is to a great extent scripturally illiterate, and so we are powerless, and we lose. 2,000 pastors a month are leaving the ministry in America. 7,000 churches a year close their doors, being replaced by about 450 or so. We're losing ground and territory, and I believe largely because we are not committed to teach, preach, and ingest the Word of God.
I agree. I mean, when you were mentioning those authors, that's all who I've read that's in my library. Whitfield, the Puritans, especially Spurgeon, Scott Wesley Brown, who's on our ATN World News team. We talk Spurgeon all the time in references and in emails. I mean, it's amazing. And I encourage you, the listener, please at least get the morning and evening devotional by Charles Spurgeon. You can get a free email version if you just Google it and look it up, and at least read that much. It's not that much to read. And ATN World News is going to be doing 1-minute Devo videos where we will be having Spurgeon and other things, and it'll just be 1 minute long. We're going to put that on our YouTube, and we're going to have our special guest maybe phone in one with a videotape on there. Cell phone and phone it in. So everybody has a minute. It just takes a minute, and it will enrich your life. Well, I feel that we've been really enriched and blessed with the truth today, and it's only the truth that sets you free. And I pray that you have ears to hear what was on the broadcast today, and may it bless you. Again, I want to thank Dallas Holm for being with us. And until next time, I'm Leah, reminding you that God loves you. Oh, how He loves you.